response to the IRMP, we did actually make the point welcome the Chair's comments and the Chief's comments. It was one of the first things that we raised in our response was the fact that actually this isn't an integrated risk management plan anymore, or we don't believe it has been for the last few years. It's a financial plan. That's exactly what it is. It's exactly that, and let's not call it anything else. The FBU can never agree to cuts or job losses. We just simply can't do that, and we don't agree, and we can never endorse reductions in fire cover. But we do recognise that the authorities' hands are tied in this instance and what they're attempting to do. Effectively making a silk purse out of a sow's ear is the comment that we use a lot. And that's faced with the unprecedented cuts that are born out of what is a Tory ideological attack. And you only have to look about how budgets are set around the country, depending on their political allegiances, to understand that and to recognise that in its entirety. There are some stuff, we do make some points in the IRMP, and it's there for you to view, I won't labour them, but we do agree with some of the stuff that is in there. We do and continually agree the whole time of firefighters are the most effective and safe use of resources for our crews and for the public that we share. You know, 20 plus hours training a week compared to 2 hours a week for retain. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to work that through. And we do support the devolution city region solution. And we don't support, and the FBU nationally do not support, the single employer model of police and fire. In our opinion, that would just see us subsumed by the process. And that's a takeover. It's vitally important for fire and fire personnel that we maintain our independence. It's that respect and trust that we have from our public that gets us through the door of some of the most vulnerable people in our society, and we need to maintain that. And I note that you do have the Brandon Lewis speech on your agenda for later, Chair, so rather than leaving it then, I just wanted to make a point on that. And our message to Brandon Lewis is quite simple. Through your IRMP, you know, we make the point in our response. It's our staff and employees, and I welcome your comments earlier today. It's our staff and our members, firefighters and control staff, who are largely responsible for still having what is something of a fire service left today. They're the people who take a reduction in national agreed rates of pay, who've lengthened the working week and given up their own time to maintain what we've still got. And they've faced below inflation pay rises for year on year and seen their pensions stolen away from under them. And then Brandon Lewis speaks about rolling out the Adrian Thomas review and the spiteful attacks on our terms and conditions, shifts and pay and everything else that that entails. And our message is that we will not stand to see further reductions in fire cover, and we won't stand to see further reductions in our terms and conditions. And just on closing, Chair, and I agree with the comments you made, and I thank you for raising them. We did, and we do go on to say, concluding on the IRMP response, that we have done everything we can to lobby councillors, MPs, government, and as the Chair put it, and we make the comments, anybody who will listen, to get more finance into the fire service, and we will continue to do that, joined up, singly, but what we also do is we urge everybody here to do the same. Thanks, Chair.
Come in and everything is self-explanatory, although we read our you know, agendas. And just to say, I'm very proud to sit on such a responsible authority as this, and the fact that the trade unions and we all get on great and everything else, not like in the past. And a special thanks to you, Dave, as well, for being, I'd say, the best chair you've ever had or ever likely to have.
Just to pile up to service needs to, I wouldn't say change because that's probably not the best word, but we need to manage the resources that we have until such times as that we can gain extra finances from elsewhere, whether we work with other partners, whether we work with the police, whether we work with the Northwest Ambulance Service, whether we work with the local authorities, whether we work with the National Health Service, anywhere that we can get extra income, then we will. Just as we had a meeting with the Chief Executive Chair of the Northwest Ambulance Service last Friday, Lesley and myself and the Chief. I thought it was a very constructive meeting, and I think we were speaking in the same language, and I think that there'll be opportunities there that we can explore to take things further, to hopefully receive a viable form of some additional resources. So it just goes to show that behind the scenes we're all working to try and improve the outlook that we have to protect our staff from all sections within the organisation, protect their jobs. And because we know that the type of individuals they are, or many of them, that they're so passionate, dedicated to what we want to do as a service, that it's an absolute disgrace. It's a shame that we're having to make so many different decisions that we do. So is there anything else that we need to raise us in Okay, if there's no further comments, can I, with the recommendations that you've got within the reports, are you happy to approve them? Okay, thank you. Thank you all very much. Okay, so now on to item 8, which is the speech from the Prime Minister.
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report is to advise members of the speech made by the Police and Fire Minister, Brandon Lewis, on the 7th of February at the think tank reform, which sets out the expectation of government over the reform of the Fire and Rescue Service. The full text of the speech is provided for the information of members at Appendix A. The key themes of the speech were around accountability and transparency, efficiency and collaboration, and workforce reform. A summary of the authority position against the three areas is set out at paragraph 6 through to 20 on pages 361 to 364. I'll very briefly summarise each of them there now. In relation to accountability and transparency, the key issue there is the Minister's talk about the introduction or the reintroduction of the Fire and Rescue Service Inspectorate, and states that the Inspectorate, when it takes effect on the 1st of April, will undertake thematic inspections which will in the first instance focus on diversity, collaboration and flexible deployment. If you look at paragraph 9, members, that sets out the makeup of Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service relative to the national position, and you'll see that our performance there compares very favourably with all of the other fire and rescue services across England, and that's borne out at Appendix 2, which sets that out in more detail. Paragraph 11 just gives some examples of collaboration, so things like the Northwest Ambulance Service Hazardous Area Response Team being co-located with the USAR team at Croxteth, the Drug Control Centre, for example, along with Northwest Ambulance Service being co-located with the Fire Rescue Service on 7 of our stations. Paragraph 12 talks about flexible deployment, and in Merseyside we have 4 shift systems in operation, only one of which is a standard grey boot shift system. The rest are covered through collective agreements with the rep bodies, and we have at the time of writing 306 of our whole time firefighters also undertake retained contracts, so that's just under half of our operational staff with retained contracts. In terms of efficiency and collaboration, you have at paragraph 14 the examples of just how we've led in relation to procurement, because ostensibly that's what the focus was on. moving across to paragraph 15, where the recognition of the service in relation to some of the collaborative activities that we've undertaken. I've given you some examples of those previously. Paragraph 16, members, just set out the potential governance arrangements which are given rise to from the Policing and Crime Act, which takes effect as of the 1st of April. And then the bullet points, you see there the representation model, which is the PCC co-opted onto a fire rescue authority as a voting member. The governance model, which effectively is the PCC takes over responsibility for the fire rescue authority, but you maintain two separate distinct functions under two chief officers. And then finally, the single employer model, which is a single chief officer that then presides over both fire and police as a corporation sole. Paragraph 17 makes reference to the Cities and Local Government Devolution Act, which sets out that a Metro Mayor can take on the responsibility of the PCC and the Fire Rescue Authority, which will be the position in Greater Manchester as of the 8th of May, and may well be a government arrangement that is that takes effect in the Liverpool City region, dependent on what happens over the next couple of years. In relation to workforce reform, members, just draw your attention to paragraph 20. One of the areas that Adrian Thomas was strongly advocating was staff surveys, and members will recall that the most recent staff survey undertaken by People Insight last year, we recorded the highest ever improvement in engagement, 19 percentage points, which was described as unprecedented, as you recall, by People Insight. So paragraph 21, just to point out there that what we're saying is that in summary, it is the view of officers that the authority is well placed to demonstrate its meeting governmental expectations against all of the areas as set out by the Minister in his speech. So I will pause at that point here and take any questions that members may have.
Okay, thanks. Any comments or questions? Anything else? Just on this, it was obviously the Chief and I were invited to this this keynote speech, and we refused to attend. Because basically, when we inquired further of what is it, like, it's already asking us to, well, go down to London on the trains and get back the time and the cost of that. And we found out that the minister was only going to do a speech for what was programmed it for an hour. Well, anybody who's read the speech has seen the movie, because when we said that we're going to go, I wanted that my comments to be relayed to to ask is that the recommendation be amended.